Yes, sir, please.
Right. So good evening, everyone. I think once again, we are back for the Thursday clinical series. And today evening, we have got two parts. First, Dr. Ashish is going to give you a quiz, which he will run through Slido, and he will tell you the instructions. The quiz is about ataxia, for which you had a case last time. And then Dr. Rakesh Singh will take you through some of the muscle power testing, which is so important in the exams. So let's start. Ashish, welcome.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, sir. So I would like to thank our fine forum for this opportunity. And without wasting further time, I'll just start the quiz. So those who are on Slido app, please note, the code is 16720. And you will get this option called polls. And then you have to put a name. If you want to remain anonymous, you can put XYZ. Or you can put your name, and then the poll will begin. So I shall start. Is the first question visible? Hello?
Yes, please go ahead.
Yeah.
So the first question is, what is the size and weight of the cerebellum in proportion to cerebrum, and what percent of total brain neurons cerebellum is comprised of? Option A, cerebellum is 1/10 of cerebrum, and 80% of the total brain neurons are in cerebellum. Option 2, half the size and 50% of the neurons. Option C, 1/5 and 30% neurons. And option D, 1/20 and 20% of the neurons. So there is a single best answer. Please choose one. The time is around 20 seconds. So most of you, more than 50% audience, has marked it correct. So please note, cerebellum, what it means is little brain in Latin. It is approximately 1/10 in size and weight of the cerebrum. The total brain neurons are around 100 billion, and the cerebellum is a machine with tightly packed with a lot of neurons. Around 80% of them are in cerebellum. And in terms of surface area, it is 75% of that of cerebral cortex. So we can imagine how powerful the cerebellum is, though it is named as little brain. So the next question, what is not true or what is false about flocculonodular lobe or the vestibulocerebellum? Option A, it receives inputs, vestibular inputs from ipsilateral vestibular nerve and vestibular nuclei. Option B, it receives visual inputs from midbrain and visual cortex. Option C, it has got a unique feature that it sends output directly to vestibular nuclei, bypassing the deep nuclei. And option D, that medial vestibular cerebellum controls eye pursuit and eye and head coordination movements, and the flocculus lateral part controls the axial musculature. So please choose the one, the best option. So most of you have marked option D, and that is the correct answer. So please note, the flocculonodular lobe or the vestibulocerebellum, it is actually primitively the oldest. That's why it is called as archicerebellum. Archi means old. And it the other parts, that is the medial vermis and intermediate, that is paravermis, is called as spinocerebellum. And the lateral, that is hemispheres, are called as cerebrocerebellum. Regarding flocculonodular, yes, it receives vestibular inputs from ipsilateral vestibular nerve and all vestibular nuclei, that is superior, medial, and inferior. Visual inputs are also received by that is midbrain and visual cortex. And as I mentioned, the unique feature, it bypasses the deep nuclei and sends outputs directly to the vestibular nuclei. So the option which is correct is medial vestibular cerebellum controls the axial musculature, and the flocculi or the lateral part covers the ocular pursuit and controlling iron head movements. So 47% have given the correct answer. Moving to the next question. Based on the somatotopy, the map representation, cerebellar vermis receives inputs from which part? Option A, distal part of the limbs. Option B, trunk and proximal parts of the limbs. Option C, both. And option D, none. So you have 20 seconds. Please choose the best possible answer. Okay, 76% have given the correct answer, that is trunk and proximal portions. Nice. So Rakesh sir had told me that all the students are very intelligent. Keep the level little tougher. I think you all know everything. So the somatotopic mapping, the vermis gets inputs from trunk and the proximal portions, and the intermediate and paravermis, that is the paravermis, receives inputs from the distal portion. I think these diagram students should note, or they may refer later in the YouTube version. I remember in my DNB paper, the first question was on cerebellum, and I was trying to remember what diagram I should draw. And in DNB, there is no option that if you know the second question, you can opt for writing second first. You have to write all questions in order. So if you see the midline, that is vermis part receives trunk then the proximal portions. It is not pictorially depicted here. But if you see the intermediate or paravermin part, that is showing the distal portions marking here, right? So we'll move to next. What characteristic oculometer finding aids in differentiating spinocerebellar ataxia type 6 from other spinocerebellar ataxia? Option A, paucity of gaze evoked nystagmus. Option B, perverted downbeat nystagmus. Option C, fixtures in square wave jerks or oscillations or ocular flutter, and option D, pendular nystagmus. So you have 20 seconds. Perverted downbeat nystagmus. More than 50% have given the correct answer. So please note the SCA2, which is common in India. We know that saccadic slowing is present in SCA2. And because there is saccadic slowing, there is impairment of production of corrective saccades. And if there is no corrective saccades production, the nystagmus would be less or even absent. So the typical gaze evoked nystagmus will be absent in SCA2. And the pathophysiology, what they say, is the excitatory burst neurons, that is the specific cell loss in the brainstem saccade generators. So SCA2 will have EBN dysfunction, and that would lead to gaze evoked nystagmus and dysmetric saccade paucity. In SCA6, the peculiar finding is perverted head shaking nystagmus. Means what we usually do is horizontal head shaking, and there is vertical nystagmus noted, typically the downbeat in SCA6. And that is considered as most sensitive parameter. And in SCA3, we can get saccadic intrusions and oscillations like ocular flutter. So this was a study published in Movement Disorder 2013, and they had given this oculomotor characteristics in different SCAs. So what we discussed, those findings are mentioned here. The most classical and peculiar is perverted downbeat nystagmus on horizontal head shaking, that is in SCA6. Going to the next question, regarding cerebellar tremor, what is false? Option A, dysfunction of cerebellar efferent pathways. Option B, the cerebellar nuclei, that is emboliform and dentate, are involved. Option C, tremor frequency is mainly below 5 Hz. And option D, that intention and rest tremors may be seen, but not the postural tremors. So the time is around 20 seconds. Please choose your options. I mean the single best option. Yes, it was actually the word game rather than the mind game, and a lot of you have chosen correct option. So in cerebellar tremor, the pathophysiology exactly is not known, but they say that the cerebellar efferent pathways are likely to have dysfunction. And the nuclei, that is emboliform and dentate, which are under inhibitory control of cerebellar cortex, are dysfunctioning. And second option, that is subcortical loop, that is dentatorubro-olivary tract or Guillain-Mollaret triangle, is also affected. In Movement Disorder Society Task Force criteria on tremor in 1998, they have given criteria for cerebellar or intention tremor. That is, it is a pure or dominant intention tremor. Please note, tremors we classify as rest tremor and action tremor. In action, we have postural, that is arms or limbs held against gravity. And next one is kinetic. In kinetic, we have simple kinetic and intention tremor. So in this, we have pure or dominant intention tremor. It can be unilateral or bilateral. The frequency is mainly less than 5 hertz. And in this, postural tremor may be present, but rest tremors are not present. So cerebellum comes into the action when we are doing any activity. In motor aspects, I am saying. So the tremors are the manifestations of various zones. So in vermal zones, we have oculomotor deficits, dysarthria, head tilt, stance and gait, all axial features. In paravermal, we have dysarthria, and lateral zone, we can have oculomotor as well as dysarthria, but additional are limb tremors, limb dysmetria, dysdiadochokinesia, decomposition of movement, dysrhythmokinesia. It is almost similar to dysdiadochokinesia, but the rhythm specifically is mentioned that is affected. Next question. Following non-motor disturbances can be observed in cerebellar disease except. So what non-motor is not seen? Option A, cerebellar cognitive affective syndrome, also called as Schmaman syndrome. Option B, it can contribute to autism spectrum disorders. Option C, it can have abnormal vasomotor response to voluntary movements like pupillary dilatation, facial flushing, hyperventilation, or bradycardia. Or option D, dysdiadochokinesia. So the time starts now. Yes, I think 40% have thought that there could be vasomotor and all these autonomic features may not be seen. But yes, the correct answer is dysdiadochokinesia, because that is a motor phenomenon. The alternate rapid movements are affected. That is the dysdiadochokinesia. And this term, dysdiadochokinesia, is my screen visible? Hello? Hello, Mansi ji?
Yes, tell me.
Yeah. So the term dysdiadochokinesia was given by Babinski, Joseph Babinski, the famous neurologist whose Babinski sign or plantar reflex we elicit in day-to-day life. So if you see the role of cerebellum in cognition and emotion, the non-motor aspects like autism spectrum disorders, the role has been described. Other thing, in lot of cerebellar ataxias, there can be neuropsychiatric features like distractibility, hyperactivity, obsessive compulsive behavior, anxiety, depression, aggressive behavior, hallucinations, lack of empathy, and avoidant behavior. Interesting feature is that cerebellum is also involved in visceromotor regulation, like it fine-tunes the autonomic centers in the brain. And because of dysfunction, cerebellar dysfunction, we can see abnormal vasomotor features like pupillary dilatation, facial flushing and hyperventilation, and bradycardia. So during examination, these subtle findings, we should also try to examine and find out. So other neuropsychiatric symptoms, if we see in attention, there is distractibility, hyperactivity, as I said, compulsive behavior as a positive symptom. Negative symptom can be obsessional behavior, difficulty in shifting attention, In emotion, as I said, impulsiveness, agitation. In negative, there is anhedonia, depression, and dysphoria. In social skill, again, there is aggression and irritability. And in negative, there can be difficulty in social interactions. In psychosis, illogical thinking, hallucination, blunt emotions. And as I said, there can be autism spectrum disorder also. Next question, I think this should be very easy. What's the likely diagnosis based on clinical radiological correlation? This is a 9-year-old male having hypotonia, ataxia, breathing abnormalities. I'm stressing on breathing abnormalities, developmental delay. Patient is having stable course. And in neuroexamination, there is moderate intellectual impairment or mental retardation, gait ataxia, oculomotor apraxia, nystagmus, strabismus, and stereotypies. Also note that systemic findings like nephronophthisis, chorioretinal coloboma, and mild increase in transaminase level is also seen. And in family history, yes, the patient is affected and his sister is also affected, second sister. So what are the possibilities? Option A, Joubert syndrome. Option B, Dandy Walker malformation. Option C, ataxia telangiectasia. Option D, cerebral tendinous xanthomatosis. So your time starts now. You have 20 seconds. Yes, 90% have given the correct answer. So what is Joubert syndrome and related disorders? So this is the group of developmental delay and multiple congenital anomaly syndromes. An obligatory hallmark is the molar tooth sign, what we saw. So why do we get this molar tooth sign? In the intrapeduncular fossa, there is hollowing and the superior cerebellar peduncles get thinned out and elongated, giving the appearance like molar tooth. And that is the hallmark of this syndrome. Patient can have hypotonia, ataxia, developmental delay, abnormal eye movements, breathing dysfunction. Please note, the patient can have hyperapnea and apnea. So classical breathing described is sighing breathing. And other systemic features like retinal dystrophy, nephronophthisis, hepatic fibrosis, and polydactyly may be seen. So the genetic abnormality like TMEM can have chorioretinal coloboma and hepatic fibrosis. That's why the patient can have raised transaminase levels. So I was just searching what other conditions can have molar tooth sign, and some weird names I have found. And to be very frank, I have no idea what these syndromes are. But for the sake of, maybe for Viva, you can know these names. Cerebellar-ocular renal syndrome, Coats syndrome, Malta syndrome, Decaben-Arima syndrome, Varadi-Papp syndrome, and senior Loken syndrome. And I'm sorry, I don't know the details of these syndromes. Next question. In day-to-day clinical practice, the most prevalent cerebral ataxia is probably chronic alcohol abuse. So what is the best biomarker which can be used to detect chronic alcohol abuse? Option A, raised serum GGT levels, gamma glutamyl transferase. Option B, carbohydrate deficient transferrin. Option C, increased MCV of RBCs. Option D, high SGPT-SGOT or AST-ALT levels. So the time starts now. Please choose single best option. Okay, so this was a little tricky thing. The correct option is carbohydrate deficient transferrin. So why it is the best biomarker? Let's know that. Please, first we would like to know that alcohol has toxic effects on the vulnerable areas, and those are synapses in the granule cells and the synapses in the Purkinje cells. Please note, alcohol itself is neurotoxic, as well as the global malnutrition caused by alcohol-related effects can cause cerebellar ataxia. And the biomarkers, yes, GGT level, ALT, AST raised, increased MCV, they all are biomarkers, but they are poor specificity. So having poor specificity, there is another good marker called carbohydrate deficient transferrin. It has got high sensitivity and specificity, reaching up to 85%. So those who are taking 50 to 60 gram of alcohol approximately per day, and approximately 2 to 3 weeks and more, they will have this CDT levels high. And the half-life of it is 14 to 17 days. And if the person is abstaining from the alcohol, it will normalize after 3 to 4 weeks. So like HbA1c, we get an idea how long CDT levels are giving, how much abuse or how much chronic use person has done. Please note that there are no drugs which can modify this CDT levels, but immunocompromised patients may have lower CDT values. And one more interesting finding about gender differences. Females may have higher CDT levels. So for the cutoff for females is around 26 and cutoff for the males is around 20. So next question, which is on neuroradiology. The mutation of this gene can cause PEO, progressive external ophthalmoplegia, Alport syndrome, epilepsy, Parkinsonism, infertility in men, and SANDO, that is sensory ataxic neuropathy, dysarthria, and ophthalmoparesis. So based on these features and based on this radiological finding, what do you think could be the diagnosis? Is it Wilson disease? It is Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease? Or is it ATM, that is ataxia-telangiectasia mutation disease, or ataxia-telangiectasia, or Polgi ataxia? Please see the findings well. The arrow, yellow arrows are mentioned, depicted. So please note these and mark the correct answer. Yes, the correct answer is Polgi ataxia. I think the clues you would have gotten are PEO and SANDO. Fine. So Polgi ataxia, please note that the cerebellar atrophy is usually very little or very mild. And as we saw, the deep cerebellar structures, the thalamus, these structures are having bilateral T2 or flare hyperintensities. Mostly they're symmetric. And why these areas are affected? That's probably these are the areas where local cerebral high energy zones are present. And because of mitochondrial disease, mitochondrial energy failure, these areas are affected and they show the hyperintense changes. The terminologies like MIRAS, that is mitochondrial recessive ataxia syndrome, and SANDO, that is sensory ataxia, neuropathy, dysarthria, ophthalmoplegia, are now included, clubbed into this ataxia neuropathy spectrum of Polgi ataxia. Regarding Alport syndrome, which I asked in the question, it is a syndrome of Polgi-related disorders. It is having seizures, liver dysfunction, and developmental regression. So the classical findings are deep cerebellar white matters, dorsomedial thalamus. Please remember these findings. Next question. So this is a 14-year-old male. He's having movement disorder, mental decline, gait disturbance for last 4 years, that is since age 10. He's got abnormal postures of neck and limbs, means the dystonia. And there are some episodes where he has generalized atonia with no loss of consciousness, but it is triggered by laughing. Patient is also having vertical supranuclear gaze palsy, and patient is having splenomegaly. So let's see the video. Is the video visible? So when the patient is laughing, suddenly he is having head and shoulders drop. There is a loss of tone there. So what are the possibilities? Option A, hypothalamic hamartoma. Option B, Niemann-Pick type C disease. Option C, chorioacanthocytosis. Option D, Kufur-Rakab disease. So based on these findings and the video, please choose your options. I think there are a lot of clues, so it should not be very difficult. Great. 69% have given correct answer, that is Niemann-Pick C. So Niemann-Pick C is a disease where there is accumulation of cholesterol and glycosphingolipids in the brain and other organs. Patient will have organomegaly in the form of splenomegaly and hepatomegaly. Neurological findings are ataxia, vertical supranuclear gaze palsy, dystonia, there can be myoclonus, gelastic cataplexy, the phenomenon where patient will have atonia or hypotonia in head and neck, as we saw in the video, and it is triggered by laughing. That's why the name gelastic. So other features can be epilepsy, cognitive decline. The genes commonly are 95% have NPC1 and 5% can have NPC2. Lab investigations we can do is plasma chitotriosidase levels or oxysterol levels. There is a Philippine test where the skin biopsy based fibroblast staining and immunofluorescence staining can give peculiar picture. That is Philippine test. And the disease modifying drug, that is miglustat, is used to halt or prevent the progression of this disease. So please note that this is a lysosomal storage disorder, and this cataplexy is considered to be REM sleep paralysis. It is seen in almost 50% of the patients of Niemann-Pick C. And the classical features like splenomegaly, vertical supranuclear gaze palsy, and cataplexy should give you the hint that we are dealing with Niemann-Pick C. One more thing is, in adolescent age group and adult age group, as the disease is progressing, this cataplexy feature regresses or reduces. And some people say that tricyclic antidepressants could be used to treat this cataplexy episodes. Why this cataplexy occurs? They say that in hypothalamus, the hypocretin levels, the cells of those which are producing hypocretin, they reduce because of this lipid storage in the brain. Moving to the next question, I think this should be easy as well. Ataxic patient having history of arthralgia, weight loss, abdominal pain, diarrhea, steatorrhea, and following clinical findings shown in the video, which I will show now. Just watch the eyes and the face carefully. So what could be this disease? What is the likely diagnosis? Option A, spinocerebral ataxia 3. Option B, PSP Richardson syndrome. Option C, Whipple disease. And option D, GAD ataxia. The time has started. Great, 99% have given the correct answer. I think there were a lot of clues and the video was very classical, the pathognomonic finding. So Whipple disease is caused by a gram-positive, non-acid fast, pars-positive bacillus, that is Trofirma whipple. And this disease will have four cardinal features: arthralgia, which is typically a migratory in nature, diarrhea, abdominal pain, and weight loss. So GI features are also very common. These joint symptoms, GI symptoms, they typically precede other manifestations. Neurologically, patient can have cognitive dysfunction, cerebellar disease, ataxia, myoclonus, hemiparesis, peripheral neuropathy, and seizures. And the classic feature what we saw is oculomasticatory myorrhythmia. It is a rhythmic, slow, convergent, divergent eye movements, and there is concurrent jaw or facial movements also seen. Sometimes patient can have even skeletal involvement, which are concurrent with these movements, like proximal and distal portions can have concurrent movement. In that case, it will be called as oculofacial skeletal myorrhythmia. And what are the treatment options? Ceftriaxone, penicillin, and if allergic to these, meropenem can be used. One more thing, in maintenance phase, patient can be used, patient can be treated with ceftran, that is cotrimoxazole, doxycycline, and the happening drug, what we have heard during COVID times, even HCQ has been mentioned in the treatment of Whipple's disease. Next question, which part of cerebellar atrophy could be related to non-motor feature like depression and emotional lability? Option A, anterior lobules. Option B, posterior lobules. Option C, both. Option D, none. So we know there are non-motor features are very common, and that is the area of interest nowadays. So please choose the correct option. Time has started. Posterior lobules. So 55% have given the correct answer, posterior lobules. And I think that explanation slide is missing, but I will just tell you the hint. Those who understand Hindi, the clue is anterior A for ataxia and P posterior for pareshani or the depression. You can just remember that way. So if you remember in the first three slides, I had shown you the anatomy, the picture where the lobules were present, 1 to 10 numbered. Those are called as larsal lobules. And the posterior part of the cerebellum or the lobules involving 8 to 10 are involved where depression can be noted. In functional MRIs and the functional studies, it has noted that the lobules 4, 5 and 6 have been noted to have activation during the happy state of mind and sad state of mind. So cerebellar activation has been noted in these lobules. And there is interesting finding is patients with depression have been noted to have smaller cerebellum also. So in this question, the posterior lobules is the correct answer. Next, the onconeural antibody associated with paraneoplastic cerebellar degeneration, which can cause, these are very classical features, laryngospasm, jaw dystonia, and opsoclonus. The option is A, CV2-CRMP5, option B, YO antibody, option C, RE antibody, option D, MATU, option E, none of these. So laryngospasm, jaw dystonia, opsoclonus. Choose your option. Okay, maybe some confusing minds now. This is a very happening topic, autoimmune and paraneoplastic. I think everyone should read that, especially for exams. So the correct option is re-antibody. Please note the jaw dystonia and laryngospasm, that is the classical feature in re-antibody. YO usually does not have non-cerebellar features. CV2-CRMP5 usually has chorea. It can have LEMS-like features, uveitis, retinitis, and limbic encephalitis. And MATU has classical features which are related to sleep, like narcolepsy, and it can also have Parkinsonian features. So this slide I would keep for the future reference, and it will be available on YouTube. And other antibodies also I'm keeping the slide for the reference. The antibodies like mGlu-R1, ITPR1, ARGH-AP26, Glu-R-Delta-2, PKC-Gamma, HOMER-3 antibodies, all these are associated with autoimmune cerebellar ataxia. We'll go to next question. Question 14. What radiological features are present in alcohol-related Wernicke's encephalopathy and which are not present in non-alcohol related Wernicke's. So option A, atrophy of mammillary bodies and cerebellar vermis. Option B, thalamic atrophy. Option C, atrophy of periaqueductal area. Option D, all of these, which is classical, present in alcoholic Wernicke's encephalopathy. Oops, I think there is problem.
For us?
No, actually, I'm just trying to call him.
I think yeah. The 13th was done.
Yeah, sure, Ashish. Please go ahead.
Can you hear me?
He still can't hear us.
So I'll just move on. I think there is some technical glitch and we are sorry for that. So we'll move.
Yeah, go ahead, Ashu.
So the re-antibody was having opsoclonus, laryngospasm and jaw dystonia. We'll move to next question. Alcohol-related Wernicke's encephalopathy, the difference between that and non-alcohol-related Wernicke's, what are the radiological features? I think this question is not coming in Slido. But anyways, I'll tell you the answer. The atrophy of the mammillary bodies and the cerebellar vermis is evident in alcohol type of Wernicke's encephalopathy, but not in non-alcohol related Wernicke's encephalopathy. One more thing is the Korsakoff syndrome is also more common with alcohol related Wernicke's rather than other non-alcohol related Wernicke's encephalopathy. So what are the features? The triad, alcohol, so you can remember GOA, G for global confusion, O for ophthalmoplasia, A for ataxia. And I do not mean to disdain GOA by this, just to remember the clue or some mnemonic, I'm saying this. So the body reserve is around 30 to 50 milligram. And when there is malnourishment for 2 to 3 weeks, it causes depletion of the stores in the thymus. So there are two subtypes, as I said. And non-alcoholic etiologies are when the person is taking polished rice as a staple diet, unbalanced nutrition, recurrent vomiting or diarrhea, maybe in pregnancy where we have hyperemesis gravidarum. Second thing, surgical resection related malabsorption. Third thing, relatively low intake as compared to increased demand like cancer, chemotherapy and systemic disease. So please remember mammillary bodies and vermis atrophy is evident in alcohol type. I'm sorry this question could not be projected there, but we'll move to next question. Question 15, patient having gradual progressive mild peripheral neuropathy, tinnitus, anosmia, night blindness, and followed by skin changes in the form of ichthyosis, dry scaly skin. His fundoscopy and skeletal features are depicted below. What is the likely diagnosis? A, Sjögren-Larsen syndrome, B, Netherton syndrome, C, Refsum disease, D, Bazin-Conswick or A-beta-lipoproteinemia. Yes, 20 seconds. Okay, so 68% have given the correct answer, Refsum's disease. So Refsum's disease is usually seen in adolescents with deteriorating vision due to retinitis pigmentosa, coming with night blindness and anosmia. Please note, anosmia is seen in Refsum disease as well as B12 deficiency also. Sensory neural hearing loss, ataxia, peripheral neuropathy, dry scaly skin ichthyosis, and cardiac conduction defects. This is having one peculiar finding called as albuminocytological dissociation, where proteins will be high without increase in cells. And treatment is phytol containing or phytonic related food should be stopped. That is meat and fats from the ruminating animals, baked goods containing animal fats, and dairy products. So the dietary intake of phytonic acid related food should be less than 10 milligram per day. And it is a lifelong therapy. Next question. This is also, I think, easy. Patient having history of cataract, ataxia, spastic paraparesis, seizures, psychiatric problems, and clinical finding as shown in the picture. I think I can point to those findings. So what is the diagnosis and treatment? Option A, gluten ataxia, and he should be tried on gluten-free diet. Option B, GAD-associated ataxia, and can be treated with IVIG. Option C, CTX treated with quinodeoxycholic acid, or option D, CTX treated with colestinol. So get ready. I hope the picture was very well noted. Great. So the option C, that is CTX and treated with quinodeoxycholic acid, is the correct option. So CTX is caused by CYP27A1 gene. There is a deficiency of sterol 27 hydroxylase, and that is why there is accumulation of cholesterol in colestanol. This colestanol is deposited in various tissues. Patient can have diarrhea, which is usually in the infantile stage. Patient can have cataract, which is usually in the first decade. And xanthomas, which can be present on knuckles, elbows, prepatellar, patellar region, or ankle, as we shown in this picture, they're visible. Please note, xanthomas can be present even in bones and even in lungs also. Patient can have premature atherosclerosis, premature aging, cardiovascular and coronary diseases. In neurologically, ataxia, pyramidal signs, mental retardation, dementia, epilepsy, Parkinsonism, multiple features can be seen. The classical finding in MRI on T2N flare is dentate, globus pallidus, substantia nigra, and inferior olive will have hyper signals, hyper intense changes. So cholesterol levels are to be checked. It is raised more than 5 to 10 times above normal, but serum cholesterol is normal or decreased. So it is the cholesterol levels. It is not used for treatment, and just as a jumble I had put in the options. So we can do, of course, the genetic testing, but supportive lab testing in the form of cholesterol can be done. Treatment for adults, quinodeoxycholic acid 250 milligram TDS is used, and for children 15 milligram per kg dose is used. Next question, match the following. So here you can choose and click multiple options which you find correct. Option one, episodic ataxia lasting seconds to minutes with persistent myokymia. Second, ataxia lasting for hours or days with interictal gaze-evoked nystagmus, rebound nystagmus, downbeat nystagmus, and migraine. Third option is ataxia lasting 10 to 30 minutes with tinnitus, vertigo, and interictal myokymia. So what do you think, which episodic ataxia matches these, whether it is 2, 3, or 1? So I know the options are complicated, but something with persistent myokymia, second, something having gaze evoked, rebound, and downbeat nystagmus with migraine, and something lasting for 10 to 30 minutes. What do you think, episodic ataxia 1, 2, 3? I know the options are a little complicated, but I hope students will be able to mark. Okay. So option one, EA1. Option two, EA2 is right. I think Slido is not able to show the third one, but yes. So where we have seconds to minutes with persistent myokymia, the myokymia which can be seen intermittently also and during episode also is EA1. The episodic ataxia lasting for hours to days with intermittent downbeat nystagmus, rebound nystagmus with migraine is episodic ataxia 2, and one with 10 to 30 minutes with only intermittent myokymia having tinnitus and vertigo is episodic ataxia 3. Great. So this is the table, and please note that acetazolamide response has been there in episodic ataxia 1, episodic ataxia 5, episodic ataxia 6, and there is a response to 4-aminopyridine noted in episodic ataxia 2. So in treatable options, these things we should know. And for the reference, I am keeping this table here. Okay, again back to anatomy. Which is the largest cerebellar peduncle? Superior cerebellar peduncle, middle cerebellar peduncle, or inferior cerebellar peduncle? So I think this should have only 15 seconds. Yes, the correct option is middle cerebellar peduncle. It is the largest one and it contains only afferent fibers. And where are these afferent fibers coming from? They are coming from contralateral pontine nuclei. So it is almost exclusively only pontocerebellar fibers. So this table is depicting cerebellar afferents involving inferior cerebellar peduncle, middle cerebellar peduncle, superior cerebellar peduncle, and efferents, that is inferior and superior. Middle is only afferent. So this again can, you can refer again in YouTube recording. For the want of time, I am not going in all these details. So the next question, which of the following CAG repeat SCAs progress most quickly? The quickest first, and which order? So option A, SCA1, then SCA3, and then SCA2. Option B, SCA3, then 2, then 1. Option C, SCA1, 2, and 3. And option D, SCA2, 1, and 3. Which is the quicker in progression in SCA1, 2, and 3? So these are the options, and you have 20 seconds. Okay, so little difficult. The correct option is SCA1, 3, and 2. So CAG repeat SCAs have different rates of progression, but SCA1 progresses most quickly, followed by 3 and 2. And in CAG repeats, the SCA6, which is considered as so-called pure cerebellar ataxia, has got slowest progression among these subtypes. This is from the Continuum, August 2019. Okay. We'll move to next question. DBS for ataxia. I mean, this is not the FDA approved indication, but as the investigational purposes, people have tried DBS in ataxia patients also. So in SCA patients, for which symptom the most consistent benefit has been shown? Tremor, dysmetria, hypotonia, or dysarthria? Yes. So, good guess. The tremor is the option. Please note that the Wim thalamus is the target usually, or the FDA approved target is Wim thalamus for essential tremor. And DBS has been the study done where the DBS
can't hear. Rakesh, can you hear Ashish?
I cannot hear him, sir.
We can't hear him.
But I think that was the last question.
Actually,
he has got disconnected.
Yeah, that was last question actually.
It's actually
Dr. Ashish has got disconnected. He's not even in the meeting right now.
Yeah. Rakesh sir, that was the last question.
That was the last question. Yeah.
Actually 9:40. What do you want to do? Do a few, Rakesh?
Yes, I'll show a few.
A few of them. Yeah. Okay, so we wait for Ashish to come back or we go ahead.
Should
I call Dr. Ashish?
Sir, am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible. Yeah.
No, actually, I think there was connection issue. What slide? At what point I missed, sir?
20. You did the 20th.
Last 20 question. Was done.
20 was done. Yeah.
Okay, I'm sorry for these technical issues. Please forgive me.
No, don't worry.
Moving now.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. So regarding cerebellar sign isometrataxia, what is true? Is it a rhythmic phenomenon like isometric tremor? Option B, it shows varying pressure during forceful contraction. Option C, it is an inability to maintain constant force during skill task. Option D, it can be seen in the first hours after MCA stroke. And option E, there is no such sign, but a good figment of imagination. So you have 25 seconds. Great. So it is an inability to maintain constant forces during skill tasks. That is the correct answer. So when we use hand, finger, or the finger, index finger and the thumb, just imagine when you're holding the needle or the paper pin and you are using it for the sensory examination, for the prick examination, how lightly you will prick the patient or touch the patient using that tip of the pin. And same pin, if you are using for attaching the bundle of, let's say, bundle of 10 papers, what amount of force will you use? The force is different. So this is the condition where we cannot maintain the constant force during skill task, like where hand and the finger coordination is used. How do we examine? We ask patient to exert a very slight and a constant pinch force using index and thumb on lateral part of examiner's thumb, and there we feel irregular pressure. So that light constant pinch is not felt. And how will you differentiate from isometric tremor? That it is not rhythmic. It will have irregular pressure feeling, and it is during the slight contractions, not when we use the forceful contractions. An interesting finding is, it has been noted that in the first hours after pica territory cerebellar strokes, this finding has been noted. I hope this was something new, or maybe you all must be knowing this. So this question, how would you rate today's quiz? Good, interesting, be bad, More toxic than ataxic questions. See, okay, kind, but would like to read more about ataxia. Sorry for the spelling mistake. And option D, please ban Dr. Ashish and we will contribute for the legal action.
Oh, you actually want to put it to vote, Ashish?
I think the fourth option. Maybe we should open fine account and people would contribute. I'm sorry for the technical issues. Please pardon me.
No, it was an excellent quiz, Ashish.
I don't know. Thankfully.
Yeah, even 11 persons are saying.
11 people want to ban you, Ashish. No, I like the quiz. It was very, very well done. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Devashish, you want to tell the winner?
Sir, actually, Ashish will only know the winner because Slido will have a control.
But I'll check, sir. I think it should be there in the...
It comes automatically.
Pops automatically.
Yeah, it pops up. With a lot of flowers and everything, it comes.
Yeah, but I didn't get that.
Okay, I think you check and tell, you know, because people will be keen to know who's done well.
I'm sorry, sir. It is not showing, actually.
Yeah. Maybe we can start with Rakesh, and if you can find it, you tell.
Okay. Yeah, good. Okay, sir. Thank you, everyone. Thanks a lot.
Very well.
Thank you very much.
So, actually, we are a little ahead of, we are running a little late. It's 9:45. So, Rakesh, you want to do a few and...
Yeah, I'll show a few muscles and
yeah.
Okay. 15 minutes and we'll go then.
Yeah, sure. Right. So Rakesh, you all know, and I think Rakesh has done in the book, Clinical what did we call the book? Neurology Simplified. Yeah. Rakesh has a CD of muscle testing. So he's been at it for quite a while and he's going to tell you a little about some muscle testing. So Rakesh.
Yes.
So, were you able to do the video setting?
No. I'll first share the screen. Let me open the keynote.
Okay. You open the keynote. Then we will do the setting again.
So, you can see my screen?
Yes.
It's seen, no? So, if I start, probably I think videos will run. No?
I think keynote, they should run. Just like that.
Just like that. Yeah, I got it. Let me just check.
Lower limb.
Yeah, fine. So I'll start from the first one. Yeah. Fine. So, so good evening, all. And, today there was some muscle, there was some clinical testing plan, but probably Dr. Srikanth could not make it. So I'll just fill up the gap. I'll show you muscle testing. You know, muscle testing, we often tend to, sir, my voice is clear, no?
Yes, you're okay. Yeah.
So muscle testing, as you all know, you know, sometimes we tend to do quite casually, you know, but I'll tell you, if you get an examiner like, sir, you know, Khadilkar, sir, he will expect you to check very precisely, you know. So this, we have done a muscle testing recording in the wards, and this is based on the Kendall muscle book, which you all must be knowing, you know. Kendall, it's a monogram of the muscle testing. Now, these are all recorded videos, and they go like this. There will be a speaker which will tell you about the muscle. That's basically from where it starts, it's the nerve supply insertion, what is the action of the muscle. Then what kind of fixation, when you want to actually test the muscle, what kind of fixations are needed, then how to actually test the muscle, and how and where to put the pressure to resist the muscle action. You know, they're all very important. Fixation, actual testing, and where to put the resistance. So just listen to the videos very, very carefully, and it is all self basically explanatory. And we have taken lower limb muscles today. So this will just tell you the movements.
Lower limb, movements at the hip joint, flexion, extension, abduction, adduction, lateral rotation, medial rotation.
Okay, so these are the very basic movements at the hip joint. These are six movements at the hip joint with chakras. Now, let us take hip flexors. You know, hip flexors are basically a group of muscles. Iliopsoas is what we know very, very commonly. There are other muscles, you know, there is psoas major, there is sartorius, tensor fasciae lata. Now, when you are checking hip flexors as a group, you don't have to flex the full thigh totally. You have to only lift it just by few inches, and that will check the hip flexors as a whole group. But if you are told to check iliopsoas in actual isolation, then you have to do a full flexion of the hip. Iliopsoas cannot be graded if you have not done a full flexion of the hip joint. Then you can also check psoas major in isolation, and the sartorius and tensor fasciae lata. So next few videos will show you how to check the hip flexors. So let's go ahead.
Flexors of the hip, iliopsoas, comprised of the iliacus and the psoas major, sartorius, rectus femoris, and tensor fasciae lata. Of these, the last three are actually two joint muscles, also acting at the knee joint. Iliopsoas, origin of the iliacus from the iliac fossa, and of the psoas major from the transverse process of lumbar vertebrae and the sacrum. Insertion of both muscles is on the lesser trochanter of femur and just below it. Nerve supply of the iliacus, the femoral nerve from L2 and L3, of the psoas major from the lumbar plexus from L2 and L3. Action, hip flexion, also lateral rotation of the hip. Position, sitting upright with knees bent over the edge of the cot. The patient should hold on to the cot to prevent leaning backwards. Supine position is preferable if the patient cannot sit due to weakness of the truncal muscles. To test for iliopsoas in sitting position, conduct full flexion at the hip joint with resistance applied at the thigh and counter pressure on the anterior shoulder. To test the hip flexors as a group, partial flexions at the hip joint, that is, lifting the thigh only by a few inches against pressure that is applied on the thigh. For iliopsoas in supine position, with the leg resting on the examiner's arm, conduct full flexion at the hip joint with resistance applied at the thigh. Note, power grading of the iliopsoas should be done in full flexion and not in partial flexion.
Okay, so that was your...
Sir, I would suggest that you select that optimize, because your video is sort of, it's breaking. Breaking as in it's not playing fluently.
Okay, so I'll select the optimize video. Where is that optimize?
So I will tell you. So just let your screen be as it is. Just stop sharing.
Stop sharing, okay.
And click on share screen once, the green button. And you will get a white window where you have a blue share button.
Wait. So I have to first stop sharing.
So your screen has stopped sharing. You have to click the green button of share.
Where is that? I'm not seeing it. I'll enter the full screen. Wait. So sorry, can you come again? That green button, no?
Green button of share screen.
Share screen. Okay.
And then there is one blue button of share. Besides that, on the left hand side.
Blue button. Okay.
After clicking the green button.
No. So I'll now share the screen desktop.
Oh no, sir. We need to check that optimize screen sharing for video clip. You have desktop. So just below the desktop, just come down. You will have share computer sound and optimize screen sharing for video clip.
Okay. First, I will do the share screening.
Yes, green button share screen.
I've done that. There is a optimize share computer yes. sound and optimize both of them.
Yes, both of them.
Okay.
And now do the share. Oh. Blue one.
Yeah. This one. Oh, it is asking password. Why? Why it is asking password? Yeah, you can see the screen?
Yeah. Yes.
Sure, I'll just start it.
Yeah. Start again.
Yeah. So we did this. This we have done. Okay. So I'll now play it. Wait. You can see it?
Yes, sir.
Psoas major. This muscle can also be checked in isolation. Position, supine. Fixation. Fix the opposite iliac crest with the knee extended. To test, hip flexion with slight lateral rotation and abduction. With pressure being applied against the distal leg in the opposite direction. Note, as the psoas major is a deep muscle, it cannot be seen during the test.
Okay.
Sartorius, origin, anterior superior iliac spine. Insertion, proximal tibia, median surface. Flexion, lateral rotation, and abduction, all in the flexed knee. This is unlike the psoas major, which works similarly, but in position of extended knee. The action of the sartorius is also to flex the knee. Position, supine, test. Flexion of the hip with lateral rotation and abduction in the flexed knee. Counter pressure is applied at the lower thigh in the direction of hip extension and adduction and at the distal leg to counter the lateral rotation. The belly of the muscle may be seen.
So you saw that psoas major and sartorius are basically same, except that while checking sartorius, you have to flex the knee because it's a double joint muscle. Otherwise, it's the same thing. You can see these videos repeatedly in the YouTube, and that will give you more idea. You know, these are little difficult muscles to check. I'll show you. Now, this is important muscle, tensor fasciae latae. Just see this.
Tensor fasciae latae. Origin, iliac crest. Insertion, iliotibial tract of the fasciae latae. Nerve supply, superior gluteal nerve from L4, L5. And S1. Action, hip flexion, abduction, and medial rotation. It tenses the fascia lata, which can readily be seen as a dimple along the lateral thigh, especially in case of pyramidal lesions. Action of the tensor fascia lata also includes extension of the knee. Position, supine, test. With the knee extended, hip flexion in slight abduction and medial rotation. Counter pressure is applied at the distal leg in the direction of extension and adduction. Avoid resisting the component of medial rotation.
So basically, if you see among all the hip flexors, it is only the tensor fasciae latae which causes a medial hip movement, in rotation. Otherwise, all are in the lateral rotation. So you have to place the limb accordingly, you know, when you are precisely checking these muscles. Now, if you, let us come to hip abductors. Now, hip abductor, you know, it's a very, very strong muscle. Gluteus medius and gluteus minimus. Gluteus medius has two fibers, anterior and the posterior fibers. And now they both carry clinical importance, you know. Anterior fibers of gluteus medius are medial rotators. And the posterior fibers, they will partially extend the hip and then actually abduct, and they cause a lateral rotation. Now it is very important, because if you check the hip abductors as a group, even in a patient of L5 root lesion, you know, despite having significant muscle weakness, the power may appear to be normal. So you have to check only the posterior fibers to pick up early weakness of the gluteus medius, and I'll show you this.
Abductors of the hip, gluteus minimus and gluteus medius. Gluteus minimus, origin, external surface of the iliac bone. Nerve supply, superior hip, also medial rotation of the hip. Position of the patient.
Yeah.
Semi-prone, with the underneath limb flexed at the knee and at the hip. Fixation. Stabilization of the pelvis. This is very important. Otherwise, the patient may substitute other hip muscles for abduction. To test, abduct the limb without any limb rotation, with pressure being applied over the distal leg.
So this was gluteus minimus.
Gluteus medius, origin, external surface of the iliac, S1. Action, abductor of the hip. The anterior fibers medially rotate the hip, while the posterior fibers laterally rotate it. Position of the patient, semi-prone, with the underneath limb flexed at the knee and at the hip. Fixation, stabilization of the pelvis. To test for the entire gluteus medius, the same test as for minimus is carried out. This will test both the anterior and the posterior fibers. However, to test specifically for the posterior fibers, abduct the hip in slight extension and lateral rotation with pressure applied over the distal leg.
So you have to basically slightly extend the leg.
For the posterior fibers separately, since abductors of the hip as a group may be normal despite having significant weakness of the gluteus medius.
Now, you know, these are very common muscles in L5 root lesions. So you need to pick up even milder weakness of gluteus medius to diagnose. Extensors, we all know it's gluteus maximus. Now, one of the important thing here is that you will note that never flex the knee when the patient is prone beyond 90 degrees, because it will extend the rectus femoris and it will prevent the extension of the thigh despite having normal power. Just see this. I'll show you quick videos.
Extensor of the hip, gluteus maximus, origin, posterior surface of the sacrum, tuberosity of the femur, nerve supply, inferior gluteal nerve 2. Action, mainly hip extension, also lateral rotation of the hip. Position, prone, with the knee flexed to 90 degrees. Avoid further flexion, as this would tense the rectus femoris anteriorly, thus preventing hip extension. Fixation at the pelvis. Test, extend the hip with pressure applied against the lower thigh. Note, in case of weakness of the gluteus maximus, during Gower's maneuver, the patient is found to try and climb up using the arms.
So this is the most common muscle getting weaker in patient of Duchenne. And patient tends to climb because of extensor weakness. Adductors are always checked as a group, and you know, just see this method, how it is ideally checked.
adductors of the hip, pectineus, adductor magnus, gracilis, longus. All five of these origin superior of the femur, nerve supply, obturator nerve from L2, action, hip adduction, and medial rotation. Position, semi-prone, with the limb to be tested, resting against the mattress. Knee extended. Fixation, hold the upper leg in abduction. Test, lift the lower leg against resistance applied at the lower thigh without any rotation, flexion, or
extension. So you saw this is the ideal method of, you know, described method of checking the power of the adductor muscles.
Rakesh, there is a question for you.
Yeah.
Can hip adductors be graded? Somebody is asking the question.
Yes, sir. So this, if we check in this manner, it can be graded. Otherwise, it is you have to only guess the grading key, the 3, 4, like that. But if you check this way, it can be precisely graded.
Correct. Yeah.
Now, lateral rotators. Remember, you know, lateral rotators, you can be asked to check. But here, you know, just see this picture.
Lateral rotators of the hip, piriformis, quadratus femoris, and obturator externus is again done as a group. Position, sitting upright, with the legs hanging and the patient holding on to the edge of the bed for stability. Fixation, not required as the weight of the body is enough to fixate the thigh on the bed. Test. The patient laterally rotates the leg, that is, moves the leg in an inward arc. Pressure is applied with one hand on the lateral thigh and the other on the distal leg in an effort to rotate the thigh medially.
So you got this. I mean, if you are checking the lateral rotation at the hip joint with the patient being seated, you have to move the leg inwards. And that will move the hip joint laterally, you know, and then you have to basically resist it. And it is reverse for patient of medial rotators. I'll just show you the...
Enough to fixate the thigh on the bed. An outward arc.
So there will be outward pressure movement will cause a medial
with
rotation.
One hand on the medial thigh.
And you have to do...
And the other hand on the distal leg in an effort to rotate the thigh laterally.
So don't do it very vigorously because it puts pressure on the hip joint. But this is the way you have to check the lateral and the medial rotators. Knee extensors, we know it's quadriceps femoris, rectus femoris, and there are 3 vasti. And there is nothing much in the muscle examination here. I'll just show you quickly.
Extensors of distal intertrochanteric line holding on to the bed. That the patient is using the rectus femoris component more efficiently than the others.
So if you see the patient leaning backwards while extending the knee, it gives you a hint that probably he is using one component of quadriceps more vigorously than the others. But that's fine. I mean, quadriceps checking is nothing more than that. Now, this is important. If you are told to check knee flexors...
Rakesh, can I make a point?
Yes,
can
sir.
I make a point?
Yes, sir.
I think the knee extensor is such a strong group of muscles that mild weakness often goes unnoticed. Yes. I mean, it's such a strong muscle that you may continue to feel that it's power grade 5 even when it starts getting affected. So don't be fooled by that fact. It's a very strong muscle.
Yes.
And when you compare it with the hamstrings are not that powerful. So the weakness comes up much easier.
Yes.
Yeah. Also, there is another question here for you. Is there something like 1+ and 1- in the grading and 3+ and 3-? I suppose the person asks about MRC grading or the modified MRC grading.
Yeah, it depends. You know, I mean, there are many muscle gradings. I mean, these are very precise gradings. You know, of course, there is 3+, 3-. Ideally, one should do like that, actually. Yeah. Fine. So we move on. Now, knee flexors. Remember, there is a medial and a lateral group. You have to remember this thing. the semimembranosus causes medial rotation at the knee joint, you know, and biceps causes a lateral rotation. So when you're checking the knee flexion, if you're not rotating the ankle joint, you know, in the medial or the lateral manner, you are checking basically knee flexors as a group. But if you are told to check in isolation, you have to do like this.
Flexors of the knee, medial hamstrings, semitendinosus and semimembranosus, lateral hamstrings, medial hamstrings, on the proximal part of the medial surface of nerve supply, medial hamstrings, flexes and medially rotates the knee and the hip joint. Action of the lateral hamstrings, flexes and laterally rotates the knee and the hip joint. Position, prone, test. To test the medial hamstrings, knee flexion with medial rotation, pressure being applied at the distal leg.
So you have to move the ankle, medially rotate the ankle.
To test the lateral hamstrings, knee flexion with lateral rotation, pressure being applied again at the distal leg.
So this will check the biceps tumors. So in isolation, you can check the knee flexors. Now these are plantar flexors. I'll just, last few videos I'll show, sir.
Sure.
Chief plantar flexors of the ankle, gastrocnemius and soleus. Plantar flexion is also assisted by the long toe flexors like flexor digitorum and hallucis longus, tibialis posterior and peroneus longus and brevis. Gastrocnemius, origin, medial head from the medial condyle of femur, lateral head from the lateral condyle of femur. Insertion, middle of the calcaneum, posterior surface. Nerve supply, tibial nerve from S1 and S2. Action, plantar flexion of the ankle. It also assists in knee flexion. Position of the patient, prone with the knee extended. Fixation, stabilize the leg. To test plantar flexion at the ankle joint without any rotation, against resistance applied at the distal forefoot. In order to elicit mild weakness, ask the patient to stand on his toes and push the body weight upwards. Note, during plantar flexion, do look for associated movements like toe flexion, inversion and eversion. This would indicate significant assistance in plantar flexion by other ankle flexors and thus indicates a weak gastrocnemius.
See, we all know how important it is to pick up the isolated gastroc weakness. You know, you have patients with myoshi, myopathy, dysferlinopathy, we always ask them to stand on the toes. But there is one more method while checking the plantar flexion. If there are something else happening, you know, the toes are flexing or the knees are inverting, it means the gastrocs are mildly weak and patient is trying to substitute other muscles in an attempt to plantar flex. So it is important to look at these associated movements to pick up early weakness. See, these are very, very strong muscles. You know, you have to pick up early weaknesses. And gastroc being two joint muscles, it has to be checked always with a knee in an extended position, unlike the soleus.
Soleus, origin, insertion.
So soleus, I'll just show you quickly.
In order to neutralize the action of gastrocnemius.
So you have to basically neutralize the action of gastrocnemius.
Fixation.
And then check for the plantar flexion.
At the distal forefoot in the direction of dorsiflexion.
Yeah. So plantar flexion in a flexed knee is soleus, in extended knee is gastrocnemius. This is another way of checking the soleus. Basically, you have to flex the knee.
Test of soleus.
Flex the knee and then check for the plantar flexion. Okay. Now, these are the last few videos. Now, ankle dorsiflexion. Remember, you know, ankle dorsiflexion with inversion is tibialis anterior. Ankle dorsiflexion with eversion is PT, peroneus tertius. Plantar flexion with inversion is classically TP. Plantar flexion with eversions are peroneus, brevis, and longus. So, remember, you know, TA is not only dorsiflexion. It is dorsiflexion with actually inversion. I'll just show you quickly.
Tibialis anterior and base of the first metatarsal of the ankle joint. It also assists in foot inversion. Position of the patient, supine. Fixation, stabilize the lower leg just above the ankle joint. Test, dorsiflexion of the ankle joint with foot inversion without great toe extension. Pressure is applied against the medial side of the foot in the direction of plantar flexion and eversion.
So the point here is I'm making is that two things. Your ankle should slightly invert when you are checking the dorsiflexion, number one. Number two, your toes, the great toe should not extend. Otherwise, patient will substitute because even the extensor hallucis longus will also dorsiflex. So it is to minimize the action of EHL. The toe, you have to ensure that toes are not extending. They are basically flexing. So these two, otherwise, I mean, TA, of course, TA power, we all check very, sometimes very casually, but this is the ideal method actually.
Tibialis posterior, origin, navicular tuberosity, action, foot inversion. It also assists with plantar flexion of the ankle joint. Position of the patient, supine, with the leg in lateral rotation. Fixation, stabilize the lower leg. Test, plantar flexion of the ankle joint with inversion of the foot. Pressure is applied against the medial side of the foot in the direction of eversion and dorsiflexion. Note, prominent toe flexion when associated with eversion indicates substitution by long flexors of the toe.
So again, you have to look at the associated movements. And while putting the resistance, you have to resist both the actions, you know, both the plantar flexion also and the inversion also. So reverse direction, you have to apply the pressure.
Rakesh, one more question has come.
Yes, sir.
That should we put our other hand on the muscle belly that is being tested or not?
It is not. I mean, the other hand actually should be used for proper fixation, like for checking TA. The other hand should be at the ankle joint to fixate it. And the other hand is, of course, checking the power. The belly will be seen, I mean, without palpating.
Yeah. I would also think that it's not compulsory. If you want to feel the contraction, you may put your hand. Yeah. But it's not compulsory. Yeah.
Peroneus tertius. Origin, distal anterior surface of the fibula. Insertion.
So tertius, I just want to show you because it is a
metatarsal bone.
It is like TA with eversion. It is primarily a everter with a dorsiflexion.
Dorsiflexes and everts the foot. This action is assisted by the extensor digitorum longus, of which the peroneus tertius is a part.
Fine.
Position of the patient, supine.
Nothing more in this.
Fixation.
Somebody had asked a question, why should the foot be inverted while dorsiflexion is checked? And the answer is here, that when you invert and dorsiflex, you're testing different muscles. When you evert and dorsiflex, you're testing different muscles.
Exactly, sir. I mean, TA is classically dorsiflexor, but it actually acts best when the foot is slightly inverted.
Correct. Yeah.
I think I'm through with the lower limb video, sir. I think
lovely. Great. I think that was very nice. That was very nice, Rakesh. It was also very nice to see the Grant Medical Neurology Seminar Room.
Yeah.
Also the fact that you haven't changed. You look the same when you did the videos. Yeah. So I think we're already at 20 past 10.
Yes,
so
sir.
I think it's time to probably close, and we must thank Ashish and Rakesh. Rakesh filled in at the last minute. Both of them have done fantastic job. If there are any questions for any one of them, you can always ask them and we'll try and answer them.
I think the question is likely to be the what are the results, and I have posted them in chat box. But if you allow, I can just declare five names.
Yeah, please do. Yeah.
So the rank one was Dr. Dhananjay. Rank two is Dr. Ashwini Hiremath. Rank three is Jos. Rank four is Sriram Reddy, and rank five is Prachi. And in chat box, I have put all the top 10 winners.
Oh, lovely. So congratulations to all. Actually, taking the quiz itself is worth the congratulations. Whether you get marks or other thing. Very nicely done quiz, Ashish.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
So the right mixture of, you know, everything. Tough prize questions, little moderately or little easier. Fantastic.
So let's close at that. Next week, what comes up? Next week, the EEG quiz.
Epilepsy, full EG quiz, and the Viva by Madam.
Yeah. Dr. Sangeeta Rawat is going to do a long quiz, and she'll also take some Viva.
Yes.
So if anyone wants to volunteer, give your names to Dr. Devashish Roikar or Dr. Rakesh Singh. Okay, so with that, signing off. Thank you very much. Good night.
Good night, sir.
Good night, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Good night.
Atish, sir, Rakesh, sir.
Yeah.
Dr. Devashish, Mansi. Thank you.
Mansi,
thank you all the participants.
Mansi, are you still there?
Yes, I'm there.
Yes, to you.
Mansi has had a very, very long day. Huh? Till 5 o'clock, she was in another meeting with us, and then she said she has one more meeting at 5. Mansi, you had your food or not?
Yes, sir. While you all were talking, I was having my food.
sir, I just want to make one point.
Yes.
Sir, I want to request all the students to volunteer for being the panelist, you know.
Yes, please. Yeah. Please make that point. Yeah.
Yeah. So, dear students, you know, this session is for you all. Ultimately, it's not an exam. It's just a preparation for exam. So, please volunteer for, you know, being panelist. You know, we have sometimes tough times to find the panelist, you know. So, please feel free to come, you know. And of course, we'll be telling you the case before, at least a week prior. So, you can always prepare for it.
Yeah.
But please, I volunteer, you know. You can give the name either to me or to Dr. Devashish.
Right.
And it's a humble request, you know, just to, the show must go on. So,
so it's much better to make mistakes here than in your final exam.